want to think a little bit about this. I mean, are you aware of how busy you are? And are you also aware of how busy you're making yourself? Most people say to me, oh, I don't know, I've done it again, overfilled the diary. Some people are subject to busyness. It's something foisted upon them. Particular inspirer of me at the moment is Pope Francis. One of the things he's saying is the threat to faith is not coming from atheism or secularism or materialism or Islam or faiths. The threat is much more utilitarian. What does he mean by that? The threat is the worship of Artemis. Artemis is the huntress in Greek mythology, and she is measured by the catch. And we now live in a society very strongly which only God regards what is measurable. If it's measurable, it's true. If it's not measurable, what is it? But the problem with that is it turns us, makes us turn up to meetings going, well, it's just a talk show. I don't know what that was for. What, a retreat? Do you not realise how busy I am? I've got a lot to do, you know. I meet people. I work in institutions where, all sorts of institutions where senior leadership would consider themselves too busy for contemplation. And so for somebody like Pope Francis, who I just want you to regard as a theologian, he's a very wise man, but he is saying to the Catholic Church at the moment, the threat to our vibrancy is busyness, performance indicators, target setting, an endless resort to strategic thinking in which ideas become more significant than realities. So he's calling Catholics back to saying, get mud back on your shoes. You've spent too long worrying about ideas. People are hurting. Which is why, by the way, I'm so grateful for this invite, because in my work, I work with a lot of Catholic schools all over the world. It's the chaplains that have got the mud on their shoes at the moment. Now, the other people are doing good work, but they are obsessed with performance. And so, the worship of Artemis is only that which is measurable counts. What are the performance indicators? And you go, well, I'm not sure that sits well with the gospel. You'll reap where you haven't sown. And actually, the fruit of your labours will be for someone else. You go, well, how does that sit in a utilitarian world of measurement, target setting, reappraisal, strategic thinking, five-year planning? You know, those things aren't bad in themselves, by the way. I'm not against lists. But this is a sculpture, you can barely see it actually, but I absolutely love it. It's just people in a hurry. They're good people. Now, it clearly isn't you. I'm delighted to hear that you, what you've done is you've gone, oh, do you know something? I think I'm getting this now. And I'm getting there slowly, myself, I'm not there yet. But another way of looking at this is these are the people you're trying to reach. And they're in a hurry. They're not bad people. So whenever I go to the pub and I ask somebody how they are, the most common answer I get is, well, I'm very busy. Oh, sorry to hear that. And then they say to me, how are you? And then I go, well, actually, I'm very busy. And then we enter into a subtle, who's busiest contest. And it plays itself out quite interestingly. So I meet this lady. She comes up to me during lunchtime on a big conference, lots of teachers. And I'm always interested by the people who choose to come and speak to me, especially in a big group. Sometimes they have something to say, and it's usually strident. She comes up to me, and I can see she's making a big lag. I'm steadying myself. Sometimes it's not great. And she comes up to me and she says, my husband, who knows what's coming next? And I said, yeah. She said, yeah, I've been listening to you. My husband, she said, is retiring this summer. And I thought, an appropriate response. I said, ooh, you must be delighted. How interesting. Surely I'm on safe ground.
You are.
She said to me, I am not delighted, and with a degree of perplexity stared at me and said, what am I going to do with him? What an interesting line. And it led me to reflect a little bit. I must have slept together for 30 years. She doesn't know who he is without his job. It's not a bad person, it's not a bad marriage. But one day, it just becomes about getting everything done. And then we almost don't know how to be ourselves. And that's why most people don't do what you're doing today. It takes courage. You're going to meet yourself. This is... jokey way I do this with schools, and please don't be offended, but I spend a lot of time in Littleham Parish Graveyard. It's a beautiful little church just down the road, and I walk the dog every day, and I'm not weird, but I do walk around talking to these people. I know they're not there, all right, I'm not into all that stuff. Okay, morning everyone. I quite like it, you know, say little prayers for them, because the names are on the stones. But, you know, there's an absurdity going on out there at the moment. When you point it out to people, they get it straight away. This is a real risk in leadership. I must demonstrate, since they're paying me more, that I work harder than you. It's terrifying. It doesn't make people bad. But here comes Gemma Simmonds. This is a little quote from this book. We can go for months, sometimes years, putting one foot in front of another, not really picking up on the patterns of consolation and desolation in our daily lives. It's an interesting prospect that the Bible repeats to us so often in the Gospels, wake up. We can get this commission as if we're sleepwalking. Most of the great contemplatives going back through the centuries would say, if you have the luxury, do what you're doing today. And stand in the field, smell the hay, and ask yourself, how are you? How's it going, David Wells? Are you still tearing around the world trying to prove how busy you are? Because actually, it does one of two things. It either makes other people feel inadequate, or it makes them feel competitive. I don't think anybody really cares. This is Blaise Pascal, of course. By means of a diversion, a man can avoid his own company 24 hours a day. And that's what the woman was saying to me in the break. I don't know know who he is without his job, and it terrifies me. Me and Annie, because we're able to talk, we're fortunate, and our three children have, one's in Manchester, one's in London, and one's in Stafford, and we almost physically said hello to each other. So, who did you become in the last 25 years? Because I know I was on your shoulder, but we loved the kids, didn't we? But, who are we now? If you don't do the things you're doing today, brave in my opinion, we lose sight of the mud on our shoes and the aspirations in our hearts. Which is why I come to these interruptions. The possibility of interruption is redemption rather than intrusion. There are many stories, but what I like about this, and forgive me, I'm speaking to people who know so much, and I know I don't know you, so I apologise if I'm stating the obvious, but at the beginning of the Synoptic Gospels, we get Matthew, Mark and Luke giving us the mission statement of Jesus, in one way or another, but broadly speaking, I've come to give you to declare the year of the Lord's favour, to bring sight to the blind and to free captives. And you get this sense that Jesus is going to lift and raise people, that there's to be redemption, that the good news is that it's not about you. And so he declares his mission statement. And then he goes from town to town in Galilee, and it all goes so very well. The people are clamouring to see him, and he's immensely successful. Then we get Peter's declaration of faith, you're the Christ. And from that moment, of course, he turns, he pivots, and then he heads for Jerusalem. That's all the strategy Jesus had. There's nothing else. Everything else in the scriptures is an interruption. He met a man on the road. They lowered these people through the roof. She had a flow of blood and touched his cloak. He's late for Jairus' daughter. He's late for Lazarus. He's constantly being interrupted. But forgive me, it wasn't the plan. Constantly we hear Jesus thanking the Father. Now, if I may say, today happened because of a plan. Good things happen because of a plan. It's not anti-planning. It's being aware that the purpose we have a plan is so interruptions happen. I love it because, I was driving here today going, just saying to myself, Lord, who shall we be today? You shall give me to discover more joy in the world. There's good people around. I'm looking forward to meeting you. Something really fresh and not knowing exactly what life's going to throw at us. The interruption can turn out to be the redemption. This lovely story of poor Simon the Pharisee. There's so many people in the Bible, particularly in the Gospels, that I have real sympathy for. I'm sure you do. We could have great fun talking about who do you read sometimes and think, oh yeah, I do feel sorry for her. I do, he didn't know what he was saying, did he? Those moments. Poor Simon the Pharisee, who's gathering, managed to get the celebrity of the moment at this time, Jesus, to his dinner. He's invited all the impressive people, and she interrupts the dinner party. And you can feel Simon's impact. understands the world in a particular way, and she is just not worthy of his household. And he's feeling the eyes in the back of his neck from the supposed great and good. But I love that line where Jesus looks at the woman, not at Simon, and says, "Do you see this woman?" Of course he does, because he's complaining about her. But that's not what Jesus is saying. He's saying, in this interruption, Simon, can you see beyond this reputation? What I love about people like you is the way you imbibe encounter into your work. Of all the places I meet in the various churches, it's in chaplaincy where I get a sense that the person in front of you matters. Now, forgive me, that would be true of clergy, of all sorts of roles in the church, but there's something about what you do that allows for intimacy. Which is why I want you to keep hearing thank you for what you do. These pictures are in your booklet. They're some of my favourite interruptions. I remember when I was training to teach, I taught secondary school pupils, and all you needed to ruin a lesson on a day like today was a wasp. It's true. Wasp. Or the man whose job it is to cut the lawns, staring through your classroom window on a hot day. Another blessing. I often think of these various interruptions. There are many of them, and I love the idea that, you know, when they brought that woman to him to stone her, he was teaching. He was in the middle of an important lesson. When they lowered the paralytic through the roof, he was teaching. One day, you will hear him call your name. Brief moment, it will utterly dignify you, because it will feel as if you're the only one. And I think that's what chaplaincy does. I really do. You can struggle to measure it, but you won't. I love that thing. What did people miss most? Nonsense. They missed you. They missed the work you do, the little touches. And in these stories, we meet a God prepared to be interrupted. And I love that. And here comes the sucker punch. Do you remember how this story starts in Luke chapter 10? So often the homily is in the first line. You know that, those of you who preach. The homily is often in the first line. Anxious to justify himself, the man asked, "Who is my neighbour?" Anxious to justify himself, the man asked, "Who is my neighbour?" And from there, Jesus is going to give us this most remarkable interruption of all. The interruption of the poor or the abandoned. And we get this breathtaking story of which there are many layers and many homilies, of course, but the proposal that the purpose of our day may have turned out to be the man in the ditch and not the meeting we were going to. I hate that. chaplaincy, if it's anything, does that, doesn't it? That's why, you know, amen to you. You who hold plans and schemes, but in the end, I suspect, don't get many of them finished. Because of the very good that you do. So, for a lot of theologians writing at the moment, and you all do your reading, of course, but there seems to be this emphasis now on ministry's encounter. That strategy sits behind it, if you like, is a platform for it. But in the end, don't make your list your reason to get out of bed, or it'll bore you to death. So, I propose a few questions, but please, this is your time. How do you assess the contribution your ministry makes? Now, what I mean is about that is like, what on earth are you doing when you're asking yourself whether you're doing well or not? Are you falling for data? Data, by the way, you know, I did 2 years of statistics. I'm not against data. In fact, I quite like it. But how are you going to understand yourself doing well? Is my question. What does doing well really look like to you? And do you fall for any of that? Are you subject to any of that? Don't forget, sometimes people have expectations of us that we have to meet. And the question always, to bring it back to Christ, are you sure you're measuring your worth the way Jesus was? If you don't mind, when you're out on your own in a minute, I can get very emotional about this, and by the way, I'm perfectly all right. I'm not having a breakdown and do this all the time. But what would he say about how when you're doing? I mean, if you dared to sit there and say, Lord, I'm amazed how often in intuition I just sense God's pleasure. I'm busy worrying about performance indicators and he's just laughing at me. The silly man. Getting all caught up in that stuff. And how do you manage the tension between your strategy and the interruption? Because don't forget, we live in a, you know, we live in a world of realities, of physical realities. There are expectations, there are job descriptions, there are tasks to fulfil. We don't get the luxury of inventing that ourselves, and neither should we. But that creates a tension then between the person who wants more of you and the task to which you're assigned. Because I know a lot of people being appointed to school chaplaincy now in large schools, and they need people like you to help them answer that question. How do you manage the tension between the interruption and the expectation? So, again, they're there for provocation and for reflection. If you don't want them, it doesn't matter. And I guess the next time we gather, we'll be gathering for lunch.
Yes, just inside the main door of the main house.
Okay. That's slightly less time between the hours. Okay. If you're a visual, like you like the visuals, the middle two pages of the book that you have, those four pictures, they're just, don't get too caught up in the style of art. I love art, but you know, don't, they're just depictions of some of